Stone on the president.
See, we're in Florida. I would say Corsi is sort of maybe the bottom feeding fish, and Kendall Rogers Stone is like the little bird inside, living off the alligator's, you know, tooth decay. And then Trump may or may not, because I never prejudge an investigation, Trump may or may not be the alligator.
Well, and but for sure we all agree that Corsi is seen as a stepping stone to Roger Stone. And you're ironically positioned outside the Miami-Dade Supervisor of Elections headquarters. You remember
his
headquarters
ironic, I agree.
18 years ago, where Roger Stone supposedly masterminded the Brooks Brother riot that supposedly
shut down.
Say
more about
that.
We discussed this on the show last night. But for folks who don't know, I mean, we're looking at a video of Roger Stone now, which is almost two decades on, as a Trump consigliere. But long before Donald Trump was considered a politician, you're saying he did what out there?
Well, what Stone supposedly did is masterminded the Brooks Brothers riot, people kind of storming the hallways. It caused the Miami-Dade canvassing board to shut down the recount. It never got started again. The rest we know is history. So the big question, and can Corsi provide a key that unlocks the door, was Roger Stone also pivotal in this election as a go-between between Guccifer, between WikiLeaks and the Trump campaign? This investigation needs to get to the bottom of that, because in many ways, that's the biggest question of all.
And in all fairness, I've said this before, in all fairness to the other individuals on the Trump campaign and the president, if the facts that Bob Mueller finds is that those things happened in an isolated way, in a rogue way, and they weren't fed back to the top of the campaign, that would be good for those individuals.
Well, and the only way to get there is to get a case against Roger Stone. Stone is clearly
he's pivotal.
He's pivotal, and he's telling everybody he thinks he's going to get indicted, that
so
he
maybe
thinks he's going to get framed.
You always reserve the right, of course, to tell the anchor on the beat that he's wrong. Maybe he's more than a little birdie.
Well, he's pretty good-sized fish. If you look at the
bigger
colorful
fish.
Character...
Okay, not a bird.
Lock the fish in.
The controversy, the color of Roger Stone, this guy has been a very high-profile operative for many years.
So that's going on one track. On the other track, Guy, you have new reporting about Michael Cohen. This is from our colleagues at CNBC, and they say he's heading back down to Washington, talking to Mueller again. We know he already reached this agreement. We know he talked to Mueller previously. What does that tell you, again, as all these things seem to be happening now post-election?
Ari, look, Mueller, I've known him a long time. He's like the RoboCop of prosecutors. The guy does not give up. So he will keep hitting these guys. And look at the building blocks that he's created so far. He's indicted, what, 12, 13 Russian nationals who are spies who hacked John Podesta's email. Kendall's 100% right. Supposedly, those were the emails that Stone was talking about and that were obtained clearly illegally and then released before the election. This all didn't just pop out of the sky and happen. There was a coordinated effort, and it's going to play out in a criminal court, is my guess.
On the presidential interview, Guy, I don't want to get too law school in here.
Yeah.
We're out in Florida. It's a balmy evening. But there's this word, interrogatories.
Yes.
That refers to when lawyers exchange written questions and answers. And they're pretty worthless. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Lawyers think they're worthless.
Yeah.
Because they're written by lawyers instead of the client. You can't catch anyone. There's no Perry Mason moment. Why would Mueller be at this juncture relying on what are essentially very fancy written questions, interrogatories with the president? Is it a prelude, you think, to some higher pressure?
You're 100% right. So it's a prelude. He's got them in front of him. He's going to look at them. He's going to say these are inefficient. He's then going to issue the grand jury subpoena to compel the president to come in and answer questions in the grand jury. And he can stand up in front of a federal judge when it comes down to it and say, Judge, I've tried everything in the book to get straight answers, and I just hadn't gotten
it. So this is important, and I'd like both your views on it. You're saying the fact that they have taken a process of written questions and answers from the president doesn't tell you that that's enough. It just tells you that might be a strategic move to then later put more pressure on.
Ari, Bob Mueller is crossing his T's and dotting his I's just like he has been throughout this case.
Exactly. He's got to really wrap this up. He's got to find out what, if anything, Roger Stone is going to tell him. And the best way to do that is make the strongest possible case against Roger Stone and see if he will come forward and cooperate. And the other thing this guy is describing, gonna have to sooner or later issue a subpoena on the president if Mueller's gonna do this the way a prosecutor would want to do this.
Well, and as Guy pointed out, under the law, RoboCop has subpoena power.
That's it.
This is what we're going to do. We're also going to talk more about, I'm glad you mentioned the Roger Stone thing, because we have more on that later in the show. It's a fascinating history. I want to thank Kendall and Guy. I want to come back to you more on some of those big issues. What we're going to do next, we're going to fit in a quick break live in Florida. Then we look at the Blue Wave with former Senator Russ Feingold when we're back in 30 seconds.